great to have you watching CNN 10. We are 10 minutes of world news explained, and I am your host, Carl Azuz. It's been a destructive week for parts of the U.S. Midwest and Southeast. For days, severe thunderstorms have roared through the region, spinning off tornadoes and causing damage in Iowa, Virginia, and the states in between. At least three people have been killed in these storms. Thousands have lost power. In Tennessee, a woman at a convenience store captured this video of heavy wind and rain blasting the earth outside. Homes and businesses were damaged. The National Weather Service said it got more than 20 reports of tornadoes or suspected tornadoes in seven states, including Tennessee and Illinois. The city of Ottawa was where at least two people died. Dozens of homes nearby were destroyed, and a glass manufacturing plant in the area was damaged. Illinois Governor Bruce Rauner said, quote, "We've got to count our blessings. This could have been way worse." Tornadoes can form at any time of the year, but they're most common in the spring.
Tornadoes are so powerful, they can flatten homes to their foundation. They can peel asphalt right off of a highway. And it can toss around 18-wheelers like they're small toys. Tornadoes can be the most deadly and destructive weather phenomenon on Earth. In fact, about 1,000 tornadoes occur every year in the U.S. That's more than anywhere else on the planet. Some of the strongest tornadoes can pack winds of 300 miles per hour or more. It can be as small as a couple hundred yards wide, all the way to 2.5 miles wide, and their path of destruction can be a couple hundred yards or extend out 50 miles or more. When conditions are just right, you'll get warm, moist air coming in from the Gulf of Mexico. That will collide with dry, cooler air from the north. When these air masses collide, it creates a lift in the atmosphere. And when you get those winds rotating and increasing speed with height, that will create a horizontal column of air that's spinning. Then you get a downdraft from a thunderstorm, and that will pull that column of air all the way down to the ground. And then you have a tornado.
10-second trivia. When officials say they're concerned about H7N9, what are they discussing? A virus, a location, an asteroid, or a plastic? H7N9 is a strain of a virus that's also known as avian influenza. Or bird flu for short. Though this virus mainly affects birds, hence the name, certain strains of it have mutated to sicken people. The Asian country of China is now going through its fifth epidemic of H7N9 since 2013. The World Health Organization says 460 people there have had confirmed bird flu infections since last October. Scientists say this year's outbreak seems worse than previous ones, and dozens of people have died. Bird flu symptoms are like those of the regular flu: fever, coughing, sore throat. The virus can be treated with certain medications. Despite this outbreak in China, health officials at the U.S. Centers for Disease Control say there's not much risk to the general public right now. But because this disease has the potential to spread, they're raising warning flags and may ramp up production of emergency vaccine. China has shut down a number of live poultry markets to prevent bird flu from spreading. Other strains that have affected only birds have been reported recently in the Middle East and especially Europe. You probably won't be surprised by the fact that slavery is illegal in every country on Earth. What is surprising is that tens of millions of people are enslaved anyway because the slave trade is worth billions to the criminals who run it. But worldwide, adults and students are raising their voices and raising money to fight slavery. Some young people are doing this by putting one foot in front of the other.
Ready, set.
Some of these teenagers are athletes, runners and swimmers used to competition, but few have faced a challenge like this. For 24 hours, teams of eight from Hong Kong-based schools will run continuous relay laps, a bold mission to raise awareness of modern-day slavery and money to fight human trafficking.
it's really like important for each other, for all of us to motivate one another.
And just keeping the main idea in mind, that we're doing this for a good cause. And this is 24 hours compared to our entire lives, which most people go through.
The Global Slavery Index estimates there are 45.8 million enslaved people across the world, and that two-thirds of them are in Asia. For the seventh year, the nonprofit Running to Stop Traffic is putting on this race, entirely organized by high school students. They race along Hong Kong's Victoria Peak and partner with runners in Kuala Lumpur, Singapore, and South Korea. Together, the Asia relays have raised more than $700,000 since 2010.
And slowly, I started to go back to my home roots. And when I found out more about the problem of slavery in India, how it manifests in many different forms, I felt really bad because I thought that I'm living in such a privileged area in Hong Kong. I always go back and I'm not really able to do some change. I slowly got more interested in the 24-hour race itself.
At 5 o'clock on a Sunday morning, the finish line feels far.
Very, very tired. 4 hours to go. A few of us have injuries, and some of us are starting to get a bit sick.
When you get a cramp and you're running and you feel like you can't go on anymore, just think about what they're going through and then keep on going for them when you can't go on for yourself. Like when you want to give up, just go on for the cause that you're fighting for.
The fuel for these runners fighting for so many others. Alexandra Field, CNN, Hong Kong.
Now taking a look at self-driving cars. The pros and cons are clear. Potentially fewer accidents, but significantly higher costs. Freeing up passengers during commutes, but a potential loss in human driving skills. When you take a look at self-driving race cars, though, one question that comes up might be, why? Isn't racing a sport for human drivers and crews? According to TheVerge.com, showing that self-driving cars can safely rocket themselves around a racetrack might make the general public feel better about self-driving cars on the street. One company developing them is having a wild ride.
This is the world's first self-driving electric race car called Robocar. And when they're out on the track, they won't have any drivers, there's no cockpit. All the cars will be exactly the same specs. The only difference will be the team behind them and the different algorithms they're creating. What makes this self-driving race car different from the typical race car that has a driver's seat?
I would say everything. It looks like a plane. With wheels, and it's super efficient in terms of aerodynamics, and it's super fast. Professional drivers cannot take the G-force which are going to be created in these type of cars. And it's super powerful, so we created a special motors for these cars, so it's almost 500 horsepower per wheel, so it's a beast. And software engineers need to find a way how to manage this power.
Do you think that the common man in the street who makes minimum wage is going to be able to relate to this, or is this kind of a sport for rich guys?
The future, in any case, is going to be driverless, so we'll see those cars and like on the roads very, very soon, much sooner than we can expect. And of course, it will touch us everyday life, and we'll see it like, and we'll accept it very, very, very quick.
When I talk to the people creating self-driving cars, they always say it's not to be cool. The real purpose is to try and eliminate car accidents. But one of your prototypes had a car accident recently in Argentina. So doesn't this defeat the purpose?
I think it's opposite, because it's a platform where all the teams are learning. When you crash, what you get a lot of data. You can understand why did it happen, how to avoid it in the future. And there is no risk for life. So this knowledge you can reuse on the real road cars. So it means that our real road cars will become safer.
So how much did it cost you?
To make?
Yeah.
Around £1 million.
So
to make this car.
A little more than $1 million. Worth it?
Yes, for sure.
So robots aren't just getting faster, they're getting more athletic, y'all. This is Handle. Why the name? Because it can pick up and handle stuff. It can also travel up to 9 miles per hour. It can balance, spin, it can go down stairs, and its vertical leap is 48 inches. When he unveiled it, the CEO of the Google-owned company Boston Dynamics said he thinks this could cause nightmares. Guess that depends on whether the 6-foot-6-inch robot is chasing you. It has excellent handling, and it's at home on a range of 15 miles, which techies will get a charge out of. But it could cause a battery of concerns for movie fans who've seen what can happen when robots get their wires crossed, go on a power trip, and cause massive dismal function. It's almost too much to handle. This is CNN 10.